specifically today, facts and figures. Now today is May the 1st. It's May Day. Now I don't know if that means anything to you, if you have any context for that. It really didn't mean much to me. I know growing up, my mother had a neighborhood friend who would always give her a gift on May 1st. May Day was something that was celebrated. And in parts of Europe and the rest of the world, May Day is a huge celebration. When I was stationed in Germany, I first got to see it in living in Idar-Oberstein, a little community outside of the barracks. We saw that they would cut down large poles, and these were May poles, and they would have streamers, and the kids would wrap them, and I don't exactly know what it all had to do, but it was one of those holidays, it's huge elsewhere, that the church didn't Christianize. You know, the church didn't, and our faith did not come about in isolation. It came about as it connected with other cultures. And as it came into other cultures, those people were religious and they were celebrating things. And some things had a lot of meaning to them and were worthwhile. And the church said, well, you know, that's sort of like, and how then do we tell the good news, the gospel? And so we used what they knew, and in that context, we said that also represents, and this is how we got a lot of our traditions, particularly around Christmas and Easter and those things that church redeemed, as we have a Savior who redeems things. Didn't happen with May Day, though. May the 1st, there will be parades all over the place and other parts of the world, great big celebrations, but not so much for us. With that being said, I wanted to point that out so we would realize that the Christian faith didn't just pop up in isolation and get handed to us today, but rather over 2,000 years through all sorts of different cultures and traditions and all through different places and languages and meanings, Christianity came. It redeemed some things, it said no to other things, and along the way it also collected some things. Every once in a while, God would put a reformer into the midst of things. In about the year 1100, he put Francis from Assisi, and he reformed the church. And then in the 1500s, we have people like Martin Luther and Calvin, who again reformed the church and bring people back by calling them to pay attention to the tradition that we've had from the beginning, and that is the Holy Scriptures. And when you look at the Holy Scriptures, that which is been collected outside of the Holy Scriptures is suspect. And it's good to do that every now and then. And I tell you this because when we look at angels today, we want to know what is it that the Judaic Christian faith has proclaimed from the beginning about angels. And you will see that a lot of what we have captured along the way is not a part of the faith. It's a part of maybe someone else's faith. It's a part of some eclectic or synaptic collection of beliefs. But what particularly has God revealed to us in Holy Scripture? Now, angels, you can see them on TV, they're all over the place. From both sets, the nasty ones and the good ones. Remember Lucifer? We did that last month. We did the nasties, now we're doing the good guys. And Lucifer was one of those angels who was nasty. What can we say we have heard about, right or wrong or in between, doesn't matter, but what can we say is out there, knowledge-wise, concerning angels? Anybody? Yes? Angels watch over me. We sing that, yeah. Yeah. Angels watch over me. Okay, so angels watch over us. What else have we heard about angels? If I just came out of the woods and have not received any kind of education at all. And I said, what's an angel? What would you be able to tell me? What do you know about angels?
A messenger of God.
A messenger of God, okay. What do they look like?
They have wings.
Wings, okay. Y'all are either afraid to share or, yes?
They have a halo over
the head. Halo over the head, okay. Pardon?
They have harps.
They have harps, okay.
I think they live in shape-shifting orbs of light.
Shape-shifting orbs of light. Yeah, I said that. That's a tongue twister. Shape-shifting orbs of light. What else?
When a bell rings,
they get their wings. Okay. That's Charlie, right? Okay. Clarence or Charlie? Clarence, okay. All right. Anything else on angels?
They do God's bidding.
They do God's bidding. Okay. Okay. Well, let me first say that beautiful anthem. Beautiful anthem. Theologically, no, not so good. Not so good. And I'll tell you why. We have a lot of stuff from all over the place on angels. But what the biblical witness is from the very beginning, it says, as do all of the three great Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, all put out there that angels exist. So do Buddhists and Hindus and Zoroastrians. So the majority of people in the world believe in the existence of angels. People much smarter than me believe in angels. People not as smart as you believe in angels. So all sorts of people from every walk of life believe in angels. So angels are something that the Bible talks about. Angel, angelos, means messenger. It means messenger. Angels are a particular personality, are a particular being that never was a human. We hear that all the time, don't we? That we go to a funeral of old Uncle Ed and we say, oh, Uncle Ed, he's up in heaven as an angel with God. Well, no, Uncle Ed, nor you nor I will ever be angels. You were created as a human, and God said, that's very good. He created angels, he created humans. He also created dogs and cats. A dog doesn't die and become a cat. An elephant doesn't die and become a giraffe. Different beings, completely different beings. We know from Scripture that some angels have wings. It talks about the seraphs, the seraphim that fly above the throne of mercy and grace. And they have six wings. With two they cover their feet, with two they cover their face, and with two they fly. So we know at least some of the angels have wings. When you think of a cherubim, we often think of Valentine's Day and maybe Cupid and a little chubby cheek, but as we read, God takes the cherubim, who aren't so cute, and puts them at the entrance to Eden with a sword that is flaming to keep humans from coming back into paradise. Okay, we lost that, we got kicked out, and he put a cherubim. You don't want to be seeing a cherubim. They are not those pretty little angelic, okay, chubby-cheeked people. They're an angel that is to scare you away, a cherubim in the scripture. What names do we have for angels?
Gabriel and Michael.
Gabriel and Michael, okay, what else? Harold. Hark the herald angel sing? No? Okay. You're right, Gabriel and Michael are the only two. No, they're not. There's one more. There's one more that's named in Scripture. Do you know who it is? Lucifer, that's right, Lucifer, bright morning star. Lucifer, Gabriel, and Michael. How many archangels? No one's guessing. You guys aren't doing Jeopardy very well here today. Okay, let me tell you. One. We often hear of all the archangels. We hear Michael and Gabriel, but it only says there's one, and it's Michael. Michael is the chief, is the general of God's angel armies. Gabriel is a messenger that God uses again and again to deliver his divine appointments to people like Abraham and to people like Isaac and to people like Mary and Joseph in a dream. So Gabriel is one who comes and speaks. The Bible has angels all throughout it doing different things. The angel of the Lord wrestling with Jacob, and the angel of the Lord that appears in the wilderness, both in the Hebrew in the Old Testament and the Greek in the New Testament. Angels are all over the place. We're going to, this month, look at this angel business. And one might ask, why? Why bother with angels? Well, if those people, most human beings that have ever lived and are living today, believe in angels. So if there are that many people from every walk of life and every faith tradition that believes in angels, I think it would be good, since our tradition, since our faith, since our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and his apostles and the early church and Paul all proclaim the reality of angels, that we know something about them. We know something about them. Now, one can fall into the danger with angels as they can with the demons. As C.S. Lewis has said, if you have a total disbelief or an unhealthy obsession, so the middle of the road when it comes to angels. Halos. Halos. Have you ever thought of an angel without a halo? You won't find a single halo in Scripture, though. Halos don't exist in Scripture. And I thought they always played harps. As you came in, we got Clarence, he's got a harp. And nowhere in Scripture do they have him playing a harp. Anybody playing a harp. There's some elders in heaven, it says, that in that great vision and revelation that are playing harps. But that's it. Angels are playing other musical instruments. And there seems to be, according to Scripture, different levels or different classifications of angels. Seraphim and cherubim and thrones and principalities and powers and choirs. Now, I know it's hard to think of choirs and angels, but that's one of the... You guys, anybody awake today? Am I being... Okay. All right. Angels and angel warriors. Now, we will be seeing angels. We will be seeing angels. For when Christ returns, he returns with the angel armies. When Christ returns, he comes with the angel armies. And the angel armies that we will see, when we see them, we know that time's up. That's it. We will, and sometimes do see, and Scripture tells us, be careful when you're with people, when you're dealing and living, because you might entertain angels unaware. I had such an experience. To this day, I will believe, as certainly as anything else I know, when I was in Bethlehem, and I'd go to Bethlehem quite often, I was living in a kibbutz between Jerusalem and Bethlehem, at Ramat Rahel, Mother Rachel, and I'd have to walk through an old minefield for a shortcut left over from the Six-Day War. But we'd go to Bethlehem. It was just about two kilometers from our kibbutz. And we would go there into Bethlehem and into the Church of the Nativity. And some of you have been to the church in the Nativity. It's in a cave in a church, and you go down some steps. Down steps and steps this way, and there's a cave, and there's a big star on the ground and glass so you can see the rock. And that is what is considered a traditional place of the birth of Jesus. We don't know exactly where. It's got to be close because Bethlehem isn't very big. So you go down these steps. Over the centuries, since about the year 300, worshippers have been making pilgrimages to the place of the Nativity. And it's during the Nativity, and it's during Christmas, that we really think angels, don't we? And almost all of the songs we have in our hymnal that mention angels are about Christmas stuff. And so I'm at the star at the Nativity one day, and I leave and go do a little souvenir shopping, and I come back, and there's a very frail older lady, and I don't know how she got down there. She was very frail. She was sitting on a bench, and she was singing in German. I don't speak German, but I knew what Silent Night sounded like in German. And she was singing Silent Night in German. And I just sat there and took it in. And my traveling companions, I wanted them to experience this. So I got up and I went out. And said, come on, come on, come on. They came down there with me. And she was gone. Now, this little frail old lady, if she was a track star, an Olympic star, couldn't have got out of there. Because there's only one way in and one way out. So I don't know where she went or how she left, but it came to me that I was listening to the voice of a Christmas angel singing to their God. That's what angels do. They sing and they praise and they worship. We don't become angels, but we will do what angels do, and that is we will worship. We will worship and praise God with perfect angelic voices, with perfect spiritual bodies, with perfect understanding, with perfect answers to every question. We will see even as we are seen. Angels understand that God loves us humans dearly. As scripture said, what angel did God ever say, you know, today, you are my begotten son. Today, I give to you all things. What angel has received the attention of a human? God tells us in Holy Scripture that angels he created to minister not only at his throne of mercy and grace, but to you as well. And next week, when it is Mother's Day, I'm right, right? It's Mother's Day? Okay. Yeah, when it's Mother's Day, what is the perfect angel topic but guardian angels? And we're going to talk about guardian angels. And scripture talks about, as we read today, ministering spirits. And what is this whole thing about guardian angels? Angels are as real as all the other things you cannot see. And I hope you understand by now that there is more you cannot see than what you can see. There's much more than what you don't know than what you do know. There's much more to what is being heard than we can hear. Smelling, all of our sensory apparatus. There's much more than we can humanly know. Angels, perhaps, are that shifting orbs of light. They can appear as they have, as animals, They can appear as humans, scripture throughout. But it says you probably won't know. You'll be unaware. You'll be unaware. So treat everyone as if they are. Let us ask the Lord to bless this word. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of the church, and we thank you, Lord, that you have designated an angel at every church. You write in that great revelation to St. John, not to the church, but to the angel of the church at Ephesus, to the angel of the church at Laodicea, to the angel of the church of all of those places. And know, Lord, we do that there's an angel here assigned to Bethany Union Church of Chicago. Lord, we just ask that we would be aware that we're not the only show in town, that there are other realities, and we are a part of your creation, a creation that you made for yourself. And we ask, O Lord, that as we continue to look at your holy word and continue to delve in and to continue to seek its wisdom, that we would learn more about our fellow creatures, these angels, and not have an unhealthy interest, but also not to have a denial, not to obsess about them, but also to be aware that there will come a day when we and they will stand together in your presence and sing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Great King of heaven, we love you, we praise you, we adore you." In Jesus, who sits at your right hand and prays for us without ceasing, we say,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let the ushers come forward that we might receive the gifts that will be given this day.
I shall unfold.
Our shall of every wind, with thunders of rain.
cup of the new covenant, his blood shed for the remission of our sins. Take, drink. Stand with me, let us pray the prayer of Messiah for us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Out into the world we go, bearing Christ in our soul. Go, look for angels, and treat everyone as if they are such. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, do this, and you change the world. Amen.
Amen. Amen.